Yeah, welcome back, everybody. Today I only have three quizzes. This is number one. This is more like a question on your understanding of quadratic and exponential functions. So just to give you an idea, the function that I use here is an exponential. So the correct answer here is C. The second question is more related. This I can now do something larger. The second question is now more related to the lecture notes. The likelihood function is again a probability, and we need to multiply the probabilities for the likelihood function for all observations. So the correct answer is A, and this is the definition that we had in the lecture notes. So that's the product of the individual dependent probabilities. And the sum of the probabilities, this is something that occurred when we took the logarithm of this, then the product turned into a summation of the individual logarithmic terms. So that's when we are talking about the log likelihood. Good, last question for the just procedure to find the maximum likelihood. So the correct answer here is, of course, number B. We take the derivative, set it to zero, and then solve for the parameters. So here, this should be. Okay, good. So far for the quizzes today. What I want to show is, again, the maximization of a likelihood function for two examples. And then I prepared an extension to the chi-square section from the lecture notes. So let's start with the maximum likelihood. And for this example, let's assume that we have measurements x1 to xn that are independent and identically distributed samples from this distribution here, which depends on one parameter, theta, here. And I just briefly plot this distribution for different values of theta. So if theta equals 1, this is the uniform probability distribution between 0 and 3. Okay, now to actually find the maximum likelihood estimator for our parameter, we write down the maximum the likelihood function, and we saw this that from one of the questions, which is the product over the probabilities for every individual value of x as a function of theta multiplied with each other in this particular case. And I take the logarithm of the likelihood function, so the log likelihood, again turning the product into this sum, and this product into this sum here minus the logarithm of the denominator, and then taking the partial derivative with respect to theta, this of this here, and setting it to zero, so we have one term n divided by theta hat. Here theta hat is now the theta that maximizes, that fulfills here the condition. And rearranging this expression to have the theta on the left hand side gives us this expression. And we now can show that this is a maximum by checking the second derivative, which needs to be zero, a negative. So the second derivative gets rid of these two terms here. So we are left with this remaining term containing the theta, which is then negative for all values of theta, because even if theta is negative, the squaring of theta makes it a positive number, so this is always negative. Okay, so this, when we know our measurements, this gives us the optimizing parameter theta. Okay, so this is just a small algebraic example. If you don't have questions to that, we can look at the second one using a different probability density. So instead of the piecewise definition, we have this one here now. And I plot this here, which looks like this. The procedure, of course, is exactly the same as before. So we write down the likelihood. So the difference here is now that this runs from 1 to 2 times n. So the limits of our product function here change a little bit. Then I take the log again, significantly simplifying this. So I'm left with the sum over the absolute deviations of x from the parameter. Taking the derivative removes the constant term here. And we are left with taking the derivative of the absolute function here, which gives us the signum function, which I show here in this inset. So taking the derivative of the absolute value of x can be done by replacing the absolute value of x with squaring x and taking the square root again. This has the same effect as taking the absolute value, but this now is the from this way we can take the derivative. So rewriting this and using the chain rule, we can write down the derivative as this, rearrange this to get x divided by the square root of x squared. And then we can reinsert our absolute x here again. So the partial derivative with respect to x of this is this. And when we look at the case x equals 0, we can take the limit of this expression x approaching 0, and this can be written as this signum function that was given here. Now, if you look at this expression, so this is a sum of these signum functions, which are either plus or minus 1. So for such an expression to be 0, we need the same number of plus and minus 1s, which means the theta must be such that for half of the terms here in the sum, theta is larger than the corresponding xi's, and for the other half it needs to be smaller, which can also be expressed with the order statistics. So when we rearrange our x values so that they are ordered from the smallest to the largest, then any number in the range between xn and xn prime and xn plus 1 prime will be exactly such that n x values will be smaller than theta and n x value will be larger than theta. So this will exactly, this will then maximize this likelihood function. Okay. Do you have questions on that? So the when we work like this, so deriving a algebraic form for the maximum likelihood estimator, this has of course the advantage you have to do this only once for such a distribution, and then you can just plug in any sample, any measurement that you have, any data, and always retrieve the maximum likelihood estimator. So when you have a repetition of sampling and then deriving the optimal parameter, if you do this only once, then of course you can also solve this numerically. So just numerically determine which one is the optimal theta. And there are, of course, many formulas where it's impossible to derive an analytic solution. And we will look at one more extended example of this, by looking at minimization of chi square. We saw in the lecture that the chi square minimization is closely related to the maximum likelihood estimate. also from, and we saw this also for the linear regression case. And in the last week, we were looking at how to extend the linear regression in case that we have errors in X and in Y. And we will today talk about how to do this when we want to perform a chi-square minimization, also with uncertainties in X and in Y. So when you recall the chi-square definition, this was basically in the original case, this was basically this. When we want to fit a linear function to some data, so we have the squared deviation from the squared deviation of the model from the data, so the squared residuals divided by the measurement, the uncertainty of every measurement, so the squared, the variance, and then summing over all. And this quantity is chi square. And then we try to find a value of A and a value of B that minimize this chi square for all our data points. So we are now about minimization of the chi square, which is equivalent to maximizing the maximum likelihood. Okay, and when we now have the case that we also have a variance in X, so an uncertainties for the X values, then we can write down the variance of this term here as the squared sum of, so the variance of this is a constant term, the A, so it doesn't contribute to the variance. And then the variance here of this, which is B times the variance in X. So we simply extend the definition of our X square, of our chi square, to divide by here the full variance instead of just the variance in Y. And we then have to, when we are looking at the chi distribution, the chi square distribution that this is following, we have one with n minus 2 degrees of freedom instead of n minus 1 degrees of freedom from the case where we only have uncertainty in Y. Okay. So, of course, we have measurement values X I, and we have uncertainty, so we can explicitly write this down, and we have then the two unknowns A and B in our expression, and we need to figure out which values of A and B minimize this sum. And the complication here is that because B is occurring in the numerator and in the denominator, this is something that cannot be solved analytically. So there is no closed form here. So we need to find a numerical solution. And we were talking in the lecture about what are possible methods to solve this. And we will take this example to walk through a few attempts to find a good numerical solution. And we will do this with the built-in capacities here of the Mathematica, but we will also do this manually, so to speak, with certain like simple methods. Okay. So for this, I want to take the data from the example of last week. So this was the data table. Let me briefly reduce the magnification here. So this was the data table where we had uncertainties in all in the dependent and in the independent variable. So these data here, and we were using linear regression to find different best fitting lines here to this data on the left hand side. And depending on whether X was considered dependent or Y was considered dependent, we had slightly different solutions. So I just take the same data here. And okay, the first thing that I do, this is our chi-square function. When we want to numerically minimize a function, we need to basically write down the function explicitly to compute the function value for any given parameters a and b. So this is my function here, and I can additionally plug in x and y values and errors in x and in y. And so practically I just test when I put in my measurements and my errors from the table here above and some arbitrary parameters for A and B, I get a number. Okay. So, and then the first thing that you do usually when you want to minimize or maximize a function is try to plot the function to get an idea how this looks like, if it's possible. Sometimes it's just not possible because of too many dimensions or so. In this case, it's possible. And this is how the function looks like. Here on the x-axis, we have the parameter a, so the intersect with the y-axis on the y-axis here, we have the slope of our linear equation. And I limit myself here to positive a's, to positive b's, because apparently this is a function with a positive slope. So I don't need any negative values of b. This is important because when we now numerically minimize a function, we need to be clear about a certain range within which we expect our parameters to be. I talk about this briefly in the lecture notes, I think, because there are two classes of optimization algorithms. The one is a local class of optimizers, and the other is a global optimizer algorithm. Global optimization means that your function is, the algorithm is designed and guaranteed to find the global absolute maximum or minimum. And this is an extremely difficult problem once we leave the one-dimensional or two-dimensional case. Even in two dimensions, it's difficult in one dimension also, but this is extremely difficult because you need to design these algorithms to work with any function. And there are some extremely badly behaving functions that have like numerous local minima. And to actually figure out which one is the absolute minimum or maximum is extremely difficult. On the other hand, local optimizers will find the local maximum or minimum in a limited range, so between minus 3 and 3. And this is a much easier problem numerically, because you can also analytically, in many cases, you can analytically prove that this algorithm will actually find the minimum in this range. Which is very important, and we will see this later also, because, as I said, such an algorithm needs to work for all functions, not only for one. So, what I do here is I plot the contour plot, and what the function that behind my command contour plot actually does is, it basically computes a large table of function values for many different combinations of A and Bs, and then tries to figure out isocontours, so what are combinations of A and B values that give me the same function value, and writes and then plots the contours. There are many different ways to do this, and there are a few ways to do this very cleverly. So, for example, it will figure out a spacing between these A and B combinations such that the curvature for the contour lines determines what the plotting density here actually is, because in this regime you need to have a closer sampling of points to actually follow the contour than here in this range, where it's basically a line. So usually these plotting functions, you have an adaptive sampling behind to figure out where they need to compute the actual function values. For our particular example, this is helpful to see that apparently there seems to be a minimum. So apparently there seems to be a minimum somewhere here. Somewhere between, I don't know, roughly between 0 and minus 1 for A and 1 and 1.5 for B. Even though this looks kind of very regular, it's pretty difficult to actually, just by looking at this, say, okay, the minimum is here. Or here, or here, or here. So that's not entirely clear, just from looking at this plot. But there is a minimum, which means when we use, for example, these ranges that I use here in the plot, this will limit our search in a box where we actually have a minimum. Good. So we now need a numerical approach to find the minimum, and we will use at first some brute force method. Brute force means we just compute all combinations of A and B and then pick the one with the smallest function value. And here all means a sufficiently dense number of combinations. So what I do here is I just put a grid of A and B combinations here on my parameter ranges, and then compute all the combinations. And I show this here with the points that I overlay. So for every point here corresponds to a combination of A and B values, and I have a function. When I put in A and B combinations, I get the chi-square value. So, and now it's simple. I just compute all the chi-square values at the position of the points here, and then I get a long table, and I just pick the A and B that gives me the smallest chi-square. So, Grid. Okay. And when we look at this value, at the points here, maybe some of these points here will prove to be the smallest one. Let's see. Let's just compute this for a second. And the smallest one is at an A of minus 0.4, so here, and 1.1, which is this. So this point here has the smallest chi-square value. Okay, now the first problem is I only get as a solution a point that I put in, so where I actually compute the chi-square. And this depends on my gridding. So what I did here is I just take the range of minus 3 to 3 and move through this in steps of 0.1. And I do the same in a y direction. When I take a coarser grid, let's do it very coarse, then this is the result. Then I compute my values at these points. And when I now compute, look at the smallest one, this is this data point here. So these are my minimizing A and B values. When I put in a intermediate gridding, then I get a different solution as the minimal A and B. So the obvious solution here is, of course, to use a very small step size in X and in Y to actually come as close as possible to the true minimum. But this means that we also compute many data points here in regions of my chi-square plane where it doesn't matter how close our points are because there is just no minimum. And if you look at the computing times, so here I compute the this grid of points with a stepping of 0.1, and this takes 0.2 seconds. And let's say I increase my resolution by a factor of 10, so not in steps of 0.1, but in steps of 0.01, then the time this takes is now a factor of about 100 higher, because I compute 100 times more points. So I have to compute my function at 100 times more position. And my function is actually a large sum. That looks like this. This is the function that I compute for every A and B, which is even squared. So this takes a couple of milliseconds, and then I have to compute it like 10,000 of times, and immediately you are in a couple of second range. You can extrapolate this. When I increase the resolution by another factor of 10, this is, instead of 15 seconds, 1,500 seconds, which is half an hour. So, here we have two dimensions because we have two parameters. If we had four parameters, an increase in factor 10 means an increase in factor 10,000 of computation times. So that means brute force method have a terrible scaling with the dimension of the problem, and you need huge computers to actually then do the brute force approach. That's also why somewhat called like this. So, but we can do this somewhat more cleverly. Let's say we have no idea about the underlying contour plot. So we can start by some rough gridding here, figure out the smallest point, and then define a region around this point in which we look somewhat closer, ignoring the regions where it's clear that where we do not expect any minimum. So this is what we do, what we will do next. So this is, we start here with this discretization. We take the minimum point, which is this one here. And now we figure out an area around this point that is guaranteed to contain our minimum. And I wrote and I formatted this here in red because this is the actual critical part. And what we do here does not guarantee that this contains the minimum, because we are just taking some naive approach, and it's actually difficult to actually guarantee this. So what we do is we take this point, and then we check all the 8 neighboring points and make sure that they have chi-square values that are all larger than this one. And then we just define here this box and say, okay, this is the minimum. On the border of this box, the function values are larger, so the minimum needs to be somewhere in the box. And so what we do basically is here, is shown here. This is the minimum. And then I take the box that is given by my grid distance here as the region in which we take a closer look for the actual minimum. Now this has a couple of problems, because I actually don't know the function values between the points. So it could be that we have contours that maybe wiggle around a little bit here around the contour points, so that the minimum could well be here, even though at this and this position the function values are higher. Yeah? So the contours here tell me that this is not a super bad approach, but if we don't know the contours, we just don't know how the function behaves between the points. So what we can do is we can, for example, be a little bit more conservative or a little bit more cautious and say, okay, let's take a larger box, just to be on the safe side, to extend the search range a little bit. And we will look at both results. Okay, so what I do is I take this box here, and in this box, I subdivide the distance between the axes again into 20 points, and then fill this grid here. So let's and then we do the same exercise again. So I filled my box here with closer lying points. So this is a zoom in now. I find the minimum here. I draw a box around this. And then I take a closer look in this box. This is now here. I try to draw the contours, but you see that they appear to be less smooth now, and that's because of numerical resolution of the plotting function. And we try to do this again and again. So we always zoom in, find the minimum, draw a box about the minimum, zoom in, and so on. And we can continue and can continue. And after 6 or 7 zooms, what I get is this value as the minimum. So basically every zoom gave me 1 additional digit here in my numerical precision. And I plot here the contour plot and the points and so for every step just to show what we actually do. But we can also leave out the plotting, start in the beginning, and just do this 10 times in a row. And then we see that we seem to approach here at this minimum. And this took us 0.5 seconds. And we have now a 8 times higher numerical resolution compared to the initial case where we filled the whole box with a fine grid. Okay. Now let's, as a comparison, repeat the same procedure with a larger box. Here I have the twice as large a search range for my box, and I do the same. And it takes about 3 times as long, which is still okay. And we had a more extended search range to make sure that we do not miss the minimum, and we get basically the same result. We expected actually that it takes 4 times as long because we doubled the number of points. So that's pretty okay. But again, when we have like 10 model parameters, this would also take pretty long. And for this reason, I wanted to show a different approach that has better scaling. In very high dimensional cases, we do it here in a 2-dimensional case, and that's a Monte Carlo method. Monte Carlo here actually means that we just compute our chi-square at random combinations of A and B values and try to find the minimum just by a random choice of search points. So for this to make sense, we need a reasonable number of random points. Let's start with 50 points. Then this is how this looks like. So we know the chi-square value for all the positions that are shown here by the points. And we select, and this would then be our minimum. Now, the problem is that when I redo this, I get the minimum at a different point because this was just randomly selected. And if I use fewer, let's maybe reduce the size here. And if I use fewer points, then I get maybe this as minimum, just because this is the one closest to the real minimum. Of course, we can do many points. But then we again have the problem that we need to compute this at many positions. Okay. Now, let's try to also do such an adaptive stepping by finding an initial gas for a minimum and then zooming in and doing again some random guessing. We'll do this with 50 points here. And then we have to think about, okay, we have a table of 50 points and we can identify the smallest function value, but how do we define now a region where we zoom in, because we don't have regular spacing and we need to come up with some measure of, okay, we expect the minimum within this range. And what I do here is I compute the distance between the minimum points and all the other points, and then I take the 5 random points that are closest to my minimum and take the average of this distance and say, okay, this is the average distance to the 5 closest points, and I expect my minimum within this distance. This is totally arbitrary, and it's not guaranteed to find the minimum, and we will see this. Because when I move in here, we slowly move away from the minimum just because we were unlucky with the placement of our random points. And when we now try to do this with looking at the closest points here, so we start with a reasonable point density, we find the minimum, we measure the distance to the 5 next points, and then we draw a box with edge length that is proportional to the mean distance to the closest neighbors. This gives me this box, and in this box I search again. And again, and so on. Now the advantage is that I still only compute 50 points instead of 400 points from our previous approach. So we have a factor of 5 that we save in, no, a factor of 8 in computation time. That's not true. And we slowly approach the minimum here, which is not the same number. We had minus 0.29, and this is close, so we are close to what we found earlier. And what do I do here? Yeah, here I do the same, just without the plotting, to actually show you how we get a result. And here we were unlucky. You see that this is a solution. Let me make this larger. This is a solution that is pretty far away from what we had earlier. And when I redo this, I get a different solution. Let's start again, maybe. And we can find something different. So we are somewhat dependent on the initial random placement. And we can, this is a little bit long. We can, when we increase the number of points, we can like get rid of this problem a little bit, but this costs again computation time. And there is no clear rule that guarantees that we approach the minimum properly. But sometimes this is the only thing you do. We can also, yeah, and here I do this with a more conservative box placement. And when I redo this, you see that, okay, here we are far away, and then we are again closer to the minimum. So this is less accurate. And one way that I can, but it takes much less time. So what we could do is we can just repeat this many times and take the average. This is just for the sake of the exercise. I do this here. And then I plot the solution, which happens to lie along this line of sight. And when we plot this in 3D, it looks like this. This line, so which is here in the projection on one line, is actually looking like this. Every point indicates a numerical solution based on our Monte Carlo approach. And it has this form because of the shape of our chi-square plane. So when we plot this in 3D, it looks like this. And when we use a different grid line pattern to actually show the contours and overplot here our solution from the Monte Carlo, you see that they actually follow here this bottom of this very shallow trough. And since this is the major axis, all the minima are lying here, the numerical estimates of the minima are lying here on this line. So that makes sense. And if I plot the linear equation for every single of these solutions, then it looks like this. So these are the different lines. Again, recall that I use here a logarithmic scaling. We can also do this in non-logarithmic plot. So this is here, excuse me. This is, do we do this? And then this looks like this. So every of these gray lines is an estimate to the minimal solution here based on our Monte Carlo. Okay. So we could now play around with this, changing the scaling of the box and so on. And then this looks different. Much more shallow, and the minima are here. Okay, good. So far for this. And at the end, I would like to compare this, like hand-woven, very naive numerical solution scheme with some of the more advanced algorithms that are built in here in Mathematica or that are typically used. This is done by using the function nminimize, which numerically minimizes a function with respect to some parameters. I just put in some limits here. And when I do this, this is the solution. We can also look at the time it took to actually find this, which is 40 milliseconds. And this is using an adaptive scheme that starts with some points and then with some clever criteria tries to approach the real minimum with a much more systematic approach. To show this, this is an example of the points that are computed when I use the differential evolution algorithm that is built in, and you see that it has a very coarse sampling here outside, and then and it is then trying to pinpoint the minimum here. And when you do this with the with different algorithms, so NELDER-MEAT is a very efficient one, or simulated annealing, then you see that depending on the algorithm, we have a very different number of computation points until they find the minimum. And we can even follow the approach. So for example, here, let's enlarge this. In this algorithm, the function started here as the first guess and then moved along here this track to actually close in on the real minimum. Or in this simulated annealing, it took somewhat more extended steps depending on the actual criteria of the algorithm. When we are looking at local optimization, then there are a different set of algorithms used. For example, the Newton method, where we just look at the slope of our function and then with some clever stepping try to pinpoint the minimum. So this is the result for just a Newton minimization. And these are the steps when we just limit our search to this box for these local minimizers, which are relatively fast because the function doesn't bother about multiple minima, local minima, and so on. So it quickly, for example, using the gradient or the principal axis here to quickly find the minimum. Okay, so this was a more technical example on how to actually find the minimum to then minimize here the chi-square estimator. With this, I would like to end.